Today I will speak with you about IOSIP. It's in a small SIP stack implementation with AsyncIO. AsyncIO, it's a module inside the Python to implement asynchronous pattern. This talk, I will try to present you why the technical reasons we implement that and how to use it in synergy of Asterisk. First, I present you. We are a Belgian company in Europe. We have two brands, in fact, based on what market we want to sell products. The first brand, it's IP. It's an open source VoIP system integrator where we do haute couture. It means, okay, a big client wants a lot of customizations, and we do that thanks to the flexibility of Asterisk. And we have a second business, allocloud.com. It's a cloud telephony and collaboration. Here, it's not the same market at all. The goal is to target the SMBs. It's more in prêt-à-porter. And we're working mainly in Europe and in not the same with an indirect sales. We have partners to sell the products instead of IP. We do the sales ourselves. Okay. Now, normally, most people have this question in mind. Why now? Who is crazy enough to re-implement a SIP stack? Because, we can find a SIP stack in most programming languages. And indeed, we already have Asterisk, we already have FreeSwitch, we already have Camelio, we already have CP. But at least to us, we don't working at the same level compared to Asterisk or FreeSwitch. It's like you comparing Apache and Nginx with Django and Ruby on Rails. Web developers knows, okay, in fact, Django is not a replacement of Apache. Apache and Nginx has use cases to serve static files. And Django enable you to implement custom business logic the clients want. It's clearly a complement between Django and Apache. And for now, to our knowledge, the SIP dialogues, the communication between endpoints and the backend are complicated to customize for a developer. Because for now, most of the time, we have Asterisk. And if you want to really customize the SIP conversation, you need to implement a C module. And here, the idea is to try to have the same building block to have the opportunity to implement SIP dialogues. Now, here, I explain you two concrete use cases. The first one is Sangoma. In fact, the main user of IOSIP is not AlloCloud, is Sangoma. Sangoma use it for to test FreePBX around the hardware. Look, I don't know very well all technical details because I'm not the developer on this part. The architect is Vodik on it. And he made a test suite tool to validate SIP signaling on smartphones and I think a little bit on FreePBX maybe. I'm not sure. Okay. And the second business use case, here it's at AlloCloud. But with IOSIP, we can implement UACSTE. UACSTE, it's a protocol that use SIP as transport. It's XML based, and you can send commands on the phone, and you can retrieve data about the phone. For example, the DND statue. You have a full control of the phone with UACSTE. But to enable you to do UACSTE, you must customize SIP dialogues. Moreover, if you need to some phones like Yealink, you can send some XML, push XML information. And for some use case, you need to send custom SIP messages. Moreover, if you want to do some proxy feature and you want to customize the proxying, it's interesting to have a programming language on it and to simply to exchange data, in fact. Okay, for now, it still smells like not invented here syndrome. Anyway, in fact, SIP has common roots with HTTP, especially for error codes, and it's text-based approach where you have attributes and you have values. Moreover, with the implementation of IOSIP, we learn and understand better the SIP constraint, especially with the pub-sub pattern with BLFs. Moreover, at AlloCloud, we don't have C skills to customize Asterisk and to be sure Asterisk won't crash with our customizations. And with that, we can have a second daemon where our code can live without to disturb Asterisk. And moreover, IOSIP is not a finished product like Asterisk, but it's simply a library that implements only SIP and nothing else. You have no RTP, you have no IVR, you have nothing, only to implement SIP signaling. And the fact it's a library, it's easier for a developer to customize the signaling. And the SIP RFCs are pretty big. It's complicated to understand. But at the end, it's simply a text sent in the socket. Okay, for a lot of scenarios, it's complicated to know what text you need to send. But for the simple use cases, it's simply send a text, retrieve a text like you have in HTTP or other protocols. And at least to me, a text-based protocol should be easy to customize. Yeah. And indeed, SIP is not a dump test-based protocol because you have a complex business logic inside to handle call, to transfer, to hang up, for BLFs also. And you need to think with the same constraints as the architects of Asterisk or Camaio, because here you have nobody to help you. You need to understand and to take the shoes of Asterisk or Camaio developers to understand why they architecture the solution like that. And personally, the implementation of IOSIP helps me a lot to understand the architecture of PGSIP. Because at the first read of Shan PGSIP documentation, okay, it seems more complex. Why it's more complex in Shan SIP, it's simpler. But it's because, in fact, in PGSIP, you'll be able to implement more use cases you can't implement with Shan SIP. And the conclusion might be, if you want to really understand SIP protocol, it should be good to implement in our programming language you use day to day. Moreover, the fact to use dynamic languages, contrary to C, help us a lot to scale this company because it's very, at least in Belgium, it's very, very, very complicated to find competent C developers, where it's easier to find Python developers. And moreover, it's very, very, very easy to crash a C process compared to on Python. It's pretty hard to crash completely all process. Moreover, but to have less security issues, Python takes care for you about memory, about resource handling. And at least to me, implement everything in C, but it's slower to implement new features simply. Because, okay, C, it's powerful, you can do what you want, but at the end, you need to write a lot of C code to implement business feature. And our clients doesn't care about the programming language you use. They only care when you will have a new feature and if it's production ready or not. And moreover, the fact we use Python means we have an access on the standard library in PyP, the Python Package Index. And in Python, you have several design patterns interesting to use, especially the asynchronous pattern. It's very useful for the to handle networking, the functional programming, the multi-worker pattern also. And for me, one killer feature we have in Python, we don't have in Node.js or Ruby, it's Cython. Cython, it's a tool enable you to write Python-like code, but at the end, you have it's like a transpiler converts the Cython code to C directly. So you have the benefits of Python, and you have the benefits of C. Moreover, we have a tool. The name now it's Pillars. We have a tool, Pillars, where inside we implemented the multi-worker plus the asynchronous plus the multi-protocol servers to be able to. It's like a multi-plug. Okay, we receive an information from HTTP, from WebSocket, from SSH, from Redis, from FastAGI, and it will be the same Python code will be executed behind the scene. It will be easier to customize, and it will be easier to reuse all ecosystem around a generic programming language. In Asterisk, you have a programming language with the Alplan, but this programming language, it's very focused on telephony, and when you want to do some basic stuff in Python or JavaScript, you can, it's complicated. For example, to manipulate text in the Alplan, it's complicated. In IOSIP, we have several modes. We have the client mode, we have the server mode. So client mode, like Zoiper, the server mode, like Asterisk, and the proxy mode, like Camaleo, where we can take a C packet from one side and redirect the packet to another side. Look, the main idea of IOSIP is try to be the most simple as possible to implement SIP protocol, SIP feature around IOSIP. So here you have an example to handle registers, where you can see in IOSIP. Okay, we have a router, like you can have in HTTP server. the principle of the router is to decide where I receive a SIP packet, where I put these packets, and how I handle this packet. And here, we define the SIP verbs, like register, like subscribe, and we link the SIP verb, for example, subscribe, with a coroutine to be able to execute code when we receive a SIP packet. Here it's an example of IOSIP server. Okay. Here it's a more concrete example from the production of IP, where here the business use case is to be able to, when somebody receives a call, all other persons in the same pickup group receive a message on the phone to know the caller ID number and the caller ID name of this person to avoid to do a blind pickup. You are aware why this phone rings. And here, when we receive an event, we retrieve inside the via the API of Wazoo the list of pickup members, and with this list of pickup members, we generate the SIP payload where you have the custom message in XML that understands a yelling phone, and here you have a simple loop where for each member we prepare the message and we launch a callback in fire and forget mode, dialog notify, with the content of the SIP message. Yeah. And here, to be able to do this implementation, in fact, we have a double registration on the phones. Via the provisioning of Wazoo, we push two SIP accounts, one from Asterisk and Wazoo, and here you have the classical telephony, and we push a second SIP account hidden on the interface of the phone to be sure the user can't see that, and where the phone is registered directly to the IOSIP daemon to be able to us to send messages through NATS, for example. Okay. Here it's another example in client mode, where we create a dialogue, and we send here it's a custom subscribe. We have a Camaleo. And we want to convert the BLFs to a WebSocket to show that in a web interface. But here, you can easily subscribe to this SIP server, and it can be a SIP server you don't have the control. For example, a Cisco SIP server. And with that, you'll be able to propose extra features even if you don't have the access to the source code of the SIP server. And with that, okay, you receive the events, and you can push back in a WebSocket or via HTTP request or via RabbitMQ, for example. Okay, and here, a third example of Asterisk proxy. Where the ID is, it's a bug fully documented in issue tracker of Asterisk, where a bounty exists, but for now nobody has fixed this bug in Asterisk. Donc, this bug is when we have BLFs, you receive SIP messages, but inside the XML of SIP message, you don't have the caller ID num and the caller ID name of the person. It means the phone, it's impossible for the phone to show the correct caller ID name. Donc, here the idea is to, we use IOSIP as a proxy. We put that behind the asterisk. Asterisk handles the SIP messages as usual. We transfer the messages. And when we see the wrong SIP message, we take the SIP message. At the same time, we're listening via AMI and now via ARI, the correct caller ID. We keep the correct caller ID in memory of the Python, and we rewrite on the fly the SIP message to the phone. And here, we can enable on the phone the fact to show correctly the caller ID number on the phone. And if somebody wants to fix this bug on asterisk to avoid to us to implement this, should be a very good idea. Donc here you have the example. Where you can see here we define the server, the proxy server, and after we rewrite on the fly the SIP messages. Okay. About the IOSIP architecture, in fact, we have tried to copycat the architecture of IOHTTP. IOHTTP is one of most active HTTP stack in Python world. It's, to my knowledge, even more active than Flask now. And here, we have a concept of applications where, okay, it represents, it's like a container where you put your business logic on it. And you have the dialogue. We have tried to map the SIP terms with the same keywords inside IOSIP. Donc a dialogue in IOSIP is like a dialogue in SIP. We implement also transactions. A transaction in SIP, it's a list of dialogues. The message itself, the SIP message. And finally, the protocol. Donc, we split the protocol. Here in the protocol, we put UDP, TCP, and also WebSockets. With that, you don't care about, okay, it's UDP, TCP, or WebSockets. It's managed by IOSIP. And you can implement your Python custom logic on the top. We did a very micro benchmark, simply to be sure it's enough efficient. We use CP for that, and we use also UV loop. It's UV loop. It's an implementation of async IO in Cython with libuv. Libuv. It's the network stack of Node.js. And with that, we'll be able to have very good performance, especially on TCP. And finally, we don't find yet CP parameters to saturate IOSIP or asterisk with options. And if somebody has some CP skills to help us on benchmarks. The benchmarks are in the repository directly. For us, it's efficient like asterisk, it's enough for us. We don't care to be the most efficient. And at least to us, the architecture and the design patterns are clearly more important than programming languages. And based on our experience, we identified three main patterns for that. The first pattern, it's the multi-worker, the fact to be able to use several processes. Now it's more, especially with Kubernetes, it's more multi-servers, but it's the same pattern, in fact. The fact to be able to use a multi-thread, it's also very important, because some operation, especially at Linux kernel, to read and write files, you need to use threads to avoid the blocking time. And the fact to use an asynchronous event loop help you to be able to handle a lot of more messages than threads. Here, the scheduling, instead of to use the scheduling of kernel, you use the scheduling of Python itself. It means with a classical Linux kernel, you can launch 1,000 of threads where with an event loop, for example, in Go, you can launch 10,000 coroutines at the same time without any issue in terms of efficiency. Because you have less context switching between processes. Donc, we already use it for two years now, and our biggest installation with it, it's 500 devices, and it consumes almost nothing in terms of CPU. We made several unit tests on it. We have TCP, UDP, and now WebSockets. And we have client, server, and proxy mode. We know the product is not yet finished. We know we need to push more documentation on it. We need to put... Vodik is working on SIP timers. We're discussing about to extract the SIP parser outside of IOSIP. You already have USSTR on our production, but we don't yet extract from it. And yeah, and about RFC compliancy, certainly some standards are not respected. And be my guest to help us to respect RFC standards. Voilà. Thanks. Do you have some questions?